Welcome back to Fix This, Build That. I'm Brad, and today we're going to be making a smart charging station with LED status notifications. I've been collecting a small stack of walnut boards that were too nasty or just not the right fit for a project. I've also got three kids who leave their tablets charging in random outlets wherever they can find them, and tablets charging on the floor or the couch can lead to this. So for this project, I decided to solve two issues in one build and try some new materials and skills that really challenged me. Spoiler, when I say challenged, I mean I failed. I pulled the walnut boards off the rack and I sorted through the pile looking for the pieces that could work. Now all the walnut that I had was rough and it needed a lot of milling to get it into a usable shape. I used my planer to get the boards flat on both sides and I started revealing that grain underneath. Now, these boards came from several different purchases that I'd made over the years, so the color and the matching consistency wasn't all that great, but I was able to put together three different panels of boards that fit pretty well together. And with a little work, I could make them look decent enough and get a really unique looking piece with some light sapwood accents on it. The three panels will be connected together with a miter joint, so I needed to make them the same width. Getting a square edge on the joiner and then ripping each board to size left me ready for the glue-ups for all three of these panels. Now the biggest thing with panel glue-ups is to make sure that you have them in the orientation you want before you start your glue-up. Now earlier I marked the ends of these boards with the light sapwood streaks in them for this exact reason. Because it's never fun to realize after the glue-up that you didn't match up the boards the way you really wanted to. It's kind of like getting dressed for work in the dark so that you don't wake up your better half. And then when you get to work you find out you've got one navy blue sock on and one black sock on. But on second thought, mismatched socks at work is probably way better than an angry wife at 7 a.m. So pay attention to your glue-ups, but blindly grab your socks in the morning and sneak out of the room like a ninja. Now the glued up panels were just wider than my planer, so I went to the drum sander to flatten them out before moving on to the next step. I designed a graphics layout for the top of the charging station and I imported it into the Easel software that runs my Inventables X-Carve. I'll be using the CNC to route the charging locations and some initials for my kids so that each of them will have their own designated spot and their own USB cord for the charging station. So I'm using the sign making router bit set from Freud, the sponsor of today's video, for the carving. I started off with the 1/4-inch carbide spiral bit to cut the landing spot grooves. Now these grooves will be cut all the way through the walnut and I'm going to fill them with epoxy and then backlight them with LEDs. The spiral bit makes nice clean cuts that removes a lot of material at a time. The bit set is great for making all types of signs with different features and cut types. It has 8 different bits including V-groove, down spiral, up spiral, tapered ball tip, and upcut spiral ball nose bits. You can do a variety of detailed relief carvings for pictures or logo works with these bits, as well as crisp lettering. Now I'll have a link below in the description to this set and you can check out all the details about them. And thanks to Freud for sponsoring this video. After the spiral bit passes were finished, I changed the bit over to the 60 degree V bit and I re-zeroed the X-Carve. It's really mesmerizing to watch the CNC do its thing with a good bit, and this is the perfect application to use CNC, as doing this cleanly by hand would be nearly impossible for me. I'm going to have LEDs running under the grooves in the top, and I wanted to fill them with epoxy to diffuse the light. But instead of embedding the LEDs in the epoxy, I wanted to make sure I could keep the electronics accessible, so I only filled half of the groove with epoxy, and I left room for the LEDs to be placed down in there. I taped off the front of the grooves, and then I flipped the top over and I leveled it out for an even pour. Then I mixed up 3 cups of high-performance epoxy with a slow hardener. White pigment added to the mix is going to give the epoxy a nice look while it isn't backlit, and then diffuse all that light really nicely when the LEDs are going around. Now each cup had just enough in it to fill one channel to the halfway point, so I poured them all in and I let the epoxy cure for about 6 hours. After that, I flipped the top over and I uncovered the initials. Now the initials won't be backlit, but I wanted to put some fun colors in there with them for the kids. I mixed up some more epoxy this time using a fast hardener, and I added orange, blue, and purple pigments to the mix. I overfilled each letter and then I let everything cure overnight so I could come back the next day and work on it. When I got back, I peeled off the tape and I realized I probably should have used something more like a Tyvek tape or packing tape versus this painter's tape. I think it would have come off a lot cleaner. The painter's tape left this little sticky residue, but I went ahead and hit the epoxy with a card scraper to remove that before sanding so I wouldn't gunk up the sandpaper. And while I was at it, I went ahead and knocked down the epoxy letters a bit too, just to keep a little wear off of the sandpaper as well. But I probably didn't need to do that because my drum sander ate through the epoxy like my kids polish off that last Oreo before I can jump in there and get it. They always get me on that. Now the shape of the charging station is pretty basic and I wanted to give it a few embellishments. I tilted my table saw to 20 degrees and I cut a chamfer on the front face of all the panels. This is going to give me a cool inset look when I put the front face on. I moved the blade over to 45 degrees and I pulled out my old table saw sled that I've dedicated to cutting miters. I started by cutting the miters on the side panels. The measurements here weren't important since I was going to be cutting them to length afterwards. Now, leaving the top panel oversized when I was doing the CNC work, let me center the design now with the cuts made on the sled. Now, one big advantage of using a sled for cutting miters is you can cut to your layout lines really easily here. Instead of trying to figure out where the tilted blade is going to hit on the top panel, you can just align your layout line on the top of the panel with the kerf cut on the back fence of the sled. But somebody in the shop wasn't too happy despite his smile. Fred the Sled has seen just about enough of this old dude getting all the work, so I went ahead and let him come in and finish off the 90 degree cuts on the side panels. I finished off the table saw work by cutting a front and a back for the charging station before moving into assembly, which definitely turned out to be the hardest part. And if you're a walnut-loving woodworker like me, make sure you get subscribed and don't miss out on more of this chocolatey goodness in my projects. And if you don't love walnut, let me know in the comments why you're wrong. I've done this full mitered glue-up in some previous projects like my epoxy waterfall table and the modern end table videos, but this one was a little bit different because I had three pieces versus the two or the four like I had in the others. I started off by using some clear packing tape across the miters to hold that miter tight when I was doing the glue-up, but it just wasn't really working out well. I'm not sure what was going on here, but the tape was just not holding nicely like it did the last time I used it. So I went ahead and switched over to the blue painter's tape, which held up way better. But you just couldn't see through it to see that corner. I used the dog holes in my workbench to hold down two right angle clamping squares to the top. And then I hinged the side up and I used more clamps to hold the side to those clamping squares. This technique works out pretty well, but you may have to adjust the clamping squares forward or backward a little bit to get them lined up just right. And definitely check the angle with your best 90 degree square before leaving it to dry, because these clamping squares do tend to flex a little bit. After the first side had dried for about 30 minutes, I repeated the process on the other side. I'm using a quick set thick glue that works really well for miters. I'm going to have a link to it and all the other items that I use for the build down below in the description. When the glue was dry, I took the table out of the clamps and I did some relief chiseling under the monograms. This is going to let the LEDs sit flush in the groove and it makes it a little place for the wires to go and not be interfered with. I'm going to have a removable bottom for the charging station so that I can easily access everything if needed. And I cut a rabbit groove on the front and the back parts to fit a 1/4-inch plywood panel. The front got attached with pocket screws on the sides and the top, and I inset the front so that it was flush with that recessed chamfer edge that I cut over on the table saw. And this is going to give that cool detail when you really look at the piece. Before moving on to the electronics, I applied a 2-part oil finish. I sanded up to 150 grit, and then I rubbed in the finish with a white Scotch-Brite pad on the sides, and I used a squeegee on the top to get it distributed, and then rubbed it in with the pad as well. The epoxy really popped with the finish, and even if you don't want to get fancy and add the LEDs, this could be a great-looking charging station as is right now. But, of course, I wanted to go to the next level, and here's where I got a little bit out of my league. I saw a video several years ago by a YouTuber called Make Josher. I'm going to link below to his video where he made a light bulb turn on or off when his phone was done charging. And I wanted to do the same type thing except use the LEDs and have some animation with it. My issue was I had no idea what I was doing because I've never done Arduino coding and this is going to be the first time working with electronics in this nature. So I'm going to go super high level here, so don't freak out if you're not into electronics. The idea here though was to use this little microcontroller, it's called the Arduino Uno, and put some code on it so I could control the set of LEDs. So I glued the LEDs in place in the epoxy channels and then I started wiring. I used a 6-port USB block to power everything. Next I wired in these little current and voltage sensors. These were the things that I saw Make Josher use in his project and it really makes the whole thing work. And this is going to let the Arduino read the current flowing through the cable, so basically it's just going to know if the tablet is actively charging or not. Now, my original plan was to just use one of these Arduino Unos. I figured out how to measure all the currents at once, but what I couldn't figure out was how to control the multiple LEDs all at the same time, because it's basically a looping program, and so it had to kind of pause before it gave the instructions to each one. So an easier way to do it is I dedicated a single Arduino to each of the tablet charging areas. Now, this is obviously a more expensive way to do it, and a smarter person than me can probably figure that out. I wired everything in place, and I secured the boards down with some screws and standoffs that I cut from little plastic straws. Then I installed the back, which is going to be a half inch shorter than the front. This left a little space at the top of the back so I could run the cables out to the top, as well as it's going to let out any heat that comes from the charging cables as well as the LEDs. I stuck the power block to the back with Velcro and I ran the charging cables out. I also did a couple cable clips on the cords so that they won't pull out the wiring if they get yanked on. Let me rephrase that, when they get yanked on by my kids. Now, programming these LEDs was a whole other adventure. I am not going to go into the details because honestly, I just did not figure it out. I tried to edit the code from Make Josher and make it work for my situation. I did get the LEDs to be off while it was not plugged in, pulse when it was plugged in, and glow a solid green when it was fully charged. Sometimes. Other times, it would just go blank after charging, or it would blink wildly when a tablet was not plugged in. So I definitely failed figuring out the coding on my own, but I'm just going to consider this a prototype as far as the coding goes, and as soon as I can figure out how to make that work and get some help from somebody smarter than me, then all I have to do is update the new code and we'll be in business. And most importantly, my kids think it's really cool that they have their own LED charging station for each of their tablets. Hey, if you want to check out some more projects, I got a playlist queued up for you right there. I think you're going to love it. Until next time, guys, get out there and build something awesome.